call this the defensive line. In the NHL, D is for defense, the buzzword in 95. D is for the Devils and their relentless style of defense that brought the Stanley Cup to New Jersey. But today, D is for draft and defense in the draft. The top three prospects all dominate from the blue line. Detroit's flashy Brian Berard, Brandon's steady Wade Redden, and Finland's Aki Berg. It is D-Day for hockey's premier 18-year-olds. 3D TV, and hey, you don't need the glasses to watch this one. Live from Edmonton, Alberta, welcome to the 1995 NHL Entry Draft on TSN and ESPN2. About 14,000 are going to pack in here to watch the NHL Draft unfold. And come on in, you've got one of the best seats in the house. You know, there's a real feeling when you talk about drafts in professional sports that it's only for the diehard fans. I mean, who really cares who the New York Islanders took in the 1992 draft in the fourth round? But when you look at it more closely, what it's really about is the grassroots. Take this year's draft, for example. Aki Berg, a young Finnish defenseman, 8 time zones away on the other side of the world. In Turku, Finland, folks are crowded around radios waiting to see whether or not this young man will be the highest player ever drafted from that country. You go to St. John's, Newfoundland, on Canada's east coast. Folks are packed into the sports bars to see where their young man, Terry Ryan, is going to go. Brian Berard from Woonsocket, Rhode Island. These communities have followed these players. What it's all about is the grassroots. A guy who's seen an awful lot of drafts, Bob McKenzie, joining me now. And what's your take on round number one? Ottawa with the first pick, pretty much a consensus.
Well, there is a consensus that Brian Berard, the young man from Woonsocket, is the guy to take. However, there was a little intrigue just before this draft is getting going, and that is the Hartford Whalers talking to the Ottawa Senators, or should I say, the Ottawa Senators talking to the Hartford Whalers about the possibility of swapping. Of course, the Hartford Whalers owned by CompuWare. CompuWare owned the Detroit Junior Red Wings, and Brian Berard was a Detroit Junior Red Wing, so they wanted to find out if there was any possibility. But when Ottawa wanted Chris Pronger, it fell apart. Hartford's not trying to trade Chris Pronger. They will for the right price, but it's not Brian Berard.
Hey, this draft is being seen all over North America, in Canada on TSN, in the United States on ESPN2. We welcome everybody. Sit back. It's going to be a lot of fun. We'll have a bird's eye view of the action from up here, but where the action really takes place, as it does in a political convention, is down behind us in the area they call the pit. The pit will be ably covered, starting with Rod Smith.
And Paul, one of the most intriguing things about the draft, some of the deals that get done before those big picks are made. Well, Ottawa is predicted to go ahead and make its pick. The New York Islanders, you can't really tell. I talked to General Manager Don Maloney about a half hour ago. Still wasn't sure if he'd be making that pick or trading it away. Stay tuned. Joining me on the floor, our analyst Gary Green. And Gary, a lot of teams would love to bump up into that top 10.
Well, Mike Keenan of the St. Louis Blues, who of course loves to play in the fast lane in the traffic, he's looking to try to move up into that top 7 picks. And so we'll watch for timeouts early in this. But a lot of teams are looking to move up. Deals for first rounders aren't easy to make.
All right, now there have been some big deals. A big one between Vancouver and Buffalo. Buffalo has to trim its payroll down from about $22 million to around $18 or $19 million. With that in mind, they send the expensive Alexander Mogilny along with a fifth-round pick to the Vancouver Canucks. In return, they receive Mike Pekka, Mike Wilson, who played this past year in Sudbury in the OHL, and Vancouver's first-round pick in this draft, which will be the 14th overall pick. Any surprises as far as that deal goes?
Well, it's not a surprise that the Buffalo Sabres have dealt Alexander Mogilny. It was very obvious what they were trying to accomplish. They were trying to lower their payroll, and in effect, they did that. However, I would like to point out that the Buffalo Sabres do apparently have to pick up some of Alexander Mogilny's $3.75 million contract next season, maybe as much as $1 million of it. So they didn't trim it maybe as much as they would have liked. For the Buffalo Sabres, they're trimming their payroll, and they're getting three prospects, Mike Pekka, Mike Wilson, and the 14th overall pick in today's draft. For the Vancouver Canucks, they're getting a temperamental superstar, a guy who some people say is a head case, but an awfully good player, and playing with Pavel Bure, his old Russian linemate from junior hockey.
All right, and Dale Hawerchuk, NHL veteran, also moving from Buffalo, signing a contract with the St. Louis Blues, a 3-year deal. Lots more to come when we come back. We get closer to the order of business in the day. That is the first pick overall. If it's Brian Berard, he'll be only the third U.S.-born player to go number one overall, the first since 1988. We'll be right back. The NHL Entry Draft and TSN is brought to you by Molson Canadian. And by Pepsi. Pepsi reminds you to be young, have fun, drink Pepsi.
Building blocks of time.
The 1995 NHL Entry Draft brought to you by Mita, CopyStar Canada, the Times Demand Mita. And by IBM, IBM Canada Limited, solutions for a small planet. All the tables down there representing all the teams, the brain trust, and in there somewhere, the New Jersey Devils table. New Jersey really building their team from the draft. 15 players on this year's Stanley Cup champion players they had drafted. Well, defensemen are at a premium in this draft. As we talked about off the top, they could, in fact, go 1, 2, and 3 the first time that would ever happen. D-men are always a hot commodity, but down the middle is also where it's at. 5 of the top 10 rated players by NHL Central Scouting heading into this draft are centermen. In the last 25 years, 13 of the number one overall picks, centermen, coming right at you down the middle.
Damon Lankow from the Tri-City Americans in the Western Hockey League is the top-rated center. Lankow led the WHL in goals last season with 67 and points with 140. He stands only 5'10" and weighs in at 175 pounds, but the gritty Lankow racked up 142 penalty minutes in 72 games. At 6'3", 204 pounds, Chad Kilger from the OHL's Kingston Frontenacs is the biggest of the top five centers. Kilger is a powerful character player who scored 42 goals and 95 points last season. Scouts compare him to Edmonton's Jason Arnott and feel he can step into the NHL next season. Steve Kelly is touted as the fastest player in the draft. Kelly stands 6'1.5" and tips the scales at 188 pounds. Combine that with blinding speed, and scouts feel he could be a tougher version of Jeff Sanderson. With Prince Albert of the WHL last season, Kelly had 31 goals and 72 points to go along with 153 penalty minutes. Peter Sikora of the Czech Republic has speed, quickness, and extraordinary hockey sense. He also has pro experience, playing last season with the Detroit Vipers of the IHL. As of January, he led the Vipers with 29 points in 29 games and was rated 4th overall by Central Scouting. But a separated shoulder caused him to miss the rest of the season. Sikora is still considered a blue-chip prospect. Another Czech, Radek Dvorak, could end up being the pick of the crop. Dvorak missed much of last season, including the World Junior Showcase with a broken wrist. The 6'1", 175-pound Dvorak played for Budějovice of the Czech Republic. He possesses world-class scoring skills and is strong enough to handle the rough stuff.
And now to the storyline that never did unfold at this draft. A couple of players were taken in 1993. Had they not been signed by the teams that took them in the first round, they would have been eligible to go back into this draft. Brendan Witt was drafted in the first round by the Washington Capitals. It was a long and bitter contract dispute. As a matter of fact, Brendan did not play hockey this year. Instead, he hung out in his hometown of Humboldt, Saskatchewan. But late last night, a deal was finally hammered out, and Witt will be playing with the Washington Capitals this year. He will not be sitting out another year, and he will not go back into the draft. It was a tough negotiation, though.
And needless to say, this has been a long and tough negotiation from both sides. We've wanted very much to have Brendan on our team for a long time, and we think, along with a lot of the other younger players that we've gotten in the entry drafts for the past several years, that the Capitals really have a good young organization, an organization that can become a lot better in the next few years.
David, you know, last night you made an offer that I just couldn't resist, and you know, we came to a deal, and I'm really pleased with that I can play with the Washington Capitals and hopefully lead the team to a Stanley Cup over the next few years, because I'll hopefully make an impact next year and be hopefully one of the top players.
By signing this year, Brendan Witt and Todd Bertuzzi also escaped the NHL rookie salary cap, which kicks in this year under the new collective bargaining agreement. Bertuzzi reaching an agreement late last night with the New York Islanders. He played this year and really upped his stock by doing so. Standing by with Rod Smith, the GM of the Islanders, Don Maloney.
Don, how close did you come to not signing Todd Bertuzzi?
Well, it was probably 11:59:50. We were right down to the wire. 11:30, we didn't have a deal. And by the grace of God, we were able to get a deal done and move on.
How about your first pick, second overall? You were saying about a half hour ago you still didn't know whether or not you were going to trade it away. How does it stand right now?
I think it's about 50-50 right now. I hear a lot of activity is happening with Ottawa on the first pick. I don't know who's going to end up with that. And depending on what happens there and who's available, we're going to make our decision at that point.
Thank you, Don.
My pleasure.
Now over to Gary Green.
I'm with Sam McMaster, the general manager of the Los Angeles Kings. And how much action has there been for your pick? You're picking third.
There's been a tremendous amount of talk, no action. What we feel is that we can right now get a player in the third pick that's going to be a franchise type player for us, and we're sticking to our guns. Even though we know that we missed the playoffs and we have to potentially improve our team this year, right now we haven't had an offer that would take away from us taking that pick.
Thanks, Sam.
You're welcome.
And the LA Kings lurking in the third spot, maybe Aki Berg territory. It's all going to unfold moments from now as the 1995 NHL entry draft gets underway when we come back.
Tak se snažím sehnat ten nový operační systém.
Watch it up Tuesday on TSN.
And welcome back to the Edmonton Coliseum, the 1995 NHL entry draft on TSN and ESPN2. The first pick to be taken by the Ottawa Senators moments away. And now let's join the commissioner of the NHL, Gary Bettman.
Good morning, and welcome to the 1995 NHL Entry Draft. We are thrilled to be in Edmonton this morning with our fans here in the Coliseum and with those of you at home on television. I want to thank Peter Pocklington, Glenn Sather, the Oilers organization, and the city of Edmonton for hosting this event. For hosting this event in spectacular fashion on very short notice. Thank you all. Draft selection is now just a few short moments away. Let's not forget that this is a time that hockey dreams for our future stars are beginning to be realized. And for the families who have sacrificed so much, today is your day as well, and we recognize your efforts. Before we get underway, just one reminder to the clubs. All first round selections will be made from the stage. When called, please bring your selection to the central registry table or hand your selection to the NHL runner posted at your table. Once confirmed, you should then proceed up here to the stage to announce your selection. The player you select will then meet you up here. Selections in the second round will be made from the microphones at your tables. Let's get started. The first selection in the 1995 NHL entry draft belongs to the Ottawa Senators.
And a foregone conclusion who they're going to take, Bob.
Well, unless they were to get a tremendous offer at the very last second, and it doesn't look as though that has happened. Team needs for the Ottawa Senators, of course, the hapless Senators they're called so often. Team needs are just about everywhere, but obviously, having picked centers with each of the first picks over the last 3 years, it's now the time has come for defensemen, and it's a good year for it. It is the year of the defenseman in the National Hockey League.
Defenseman expected to go 1, 2, and 3, and Ryan Berard is the man who will quite likely go number one. He'll be the third U.S.-born player ever to be bestowed with that honor. It hasn't happened since 1988 when Mike Modano went first overall to Minnesota. Brian Lawton went first overall to Minnesota in 1983.
Big John Ferguson, former Montreal Canadian tough guy, general manager with the Winnipeg Jets, the New York Rangers, makes his way to the podium with the black Ottawa Senators jersey. And I don't think there's going to be any surprise here, Paul. Their young man is Brian Berard from Woonsocket, Rhode Island, member of the Detroit Junior Red Wings.
Welcome, great fans of Edmonton. The Ottawa Senators are pleased and proud to select with the first pick overall this year from the Detroit Junior Whalers, Brian Berard.
Canadian Hockey League Rookie of the Year, a take-charge, aggressive defenseman. There are some concerns about his hockey sense and whether that can be developed.
Well, what he is he's a be-the-difference kind of hockey player. When he's on the ice, he wants to end the game or win the game right there. And John Ferguson said in all the years he scouted, he's never seen anybody go from hero to goat and back to hero so quickly. He's a cross between a Brian Leetch and a Chris Chelios. He's got the edge of a Chris Chelios, a very feisty guy who doesn't take any nonsense. He's also got the great skating ability and some offensive flair like Brian Leetch. No one can guarantee that he's going to be as good as Brian Leetch or Chris Chelios, but he has those kind of qualities, and John Ferguson believes this guy could be a star in the National Hockey League.
It's his moment.
Brian Berard, the young American, said he has absolutely no qualms whatsoever about playing anywhere in the National Hockey League, including Canada, and especially in Ottawa, the last place overall team. Team struggling very hard to carve an identity for itself that isn't as a loser.
And you heard Gary Bettman acknowledge the sacrifices of the families that they've made for all these years. This is the day. This is the realization of a dream for the kid and also for the family. And Brian Berard is drinking it in along with his family, the number one pick.
Paul, he left Mount St. Charles High School, a very prestigious high school in Rhode Island, to become a member of the Detroit Junior Wings, who have since changed their name to the Detroit Junior Whalers. And now Brian Berard joins our Rod Smith along with John Ferguson.
Well, Brian, congratulations. You must have known this was coming just the same. How does it feel?
It's great. I mean, I'm just proud to be selected. This is every boy's dream to be drafted, but I mean, this is just the first step. I got to go work hard every day after, and we'll see what happens come training camp.
John, I got to talk to you just a few minutes before this all came about. You had no doubt in your mind this was the pick of the crop.
None whatsoever. He'll be able to run our power play for 10 years, and he's quite a player. I watched him probably 65% of his games this year, and he just got better as the year went on. Really happy with it.
Congratulations once again.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So a defenseman goes number one overall, as was the case last year when Ed Jovanovski went first overall.
The next selection, the second pick in the 1995 NHL entry draft, belongs to the New York Islanders. And I also want to announce a trade. Buffalo trades Alexander Mogilny and Buffalo's fifth-round pick in 1995 to Vancouver in exchange for Vancouver's first-round pick in the 1995 entry draft and players Mike Pekka and Mike Wilson.
So once again, you hear that trade being confirmed by the NHL Commissioner Gary Bettman. Not a total shocker knowing that Buffalo does have to trim the payroll.
No, but it could be an impact trade for the Vancouver Canucks. They now have Alexander Mogilny and Pavel Bure. When those two players have their minds on the game of hockey and are focused on playing well, they can be as dynamic and as exciting as anybody in the National Hockey League. They played together as juniors in the 1989 World Junior Championship. Now all they need is Sergei Fedorov from the Detroit Red Wings, and that would complete the unification of that line. But the Vancouver Canucks gave up three prospects, Mike Pekka, Mike Wilson, and the 14th pick in today's draft for a guy that they believe can be a game breaker, a guy who can score 70 or 80 goals in the National Hockey League.
Pick number two belonging to the New York Islanders.
Well, there's been a lot of speculation what the Islanders would do. A lot of people think they're after a big center because they need front the big man up front, but they've signed Bertuzzi, they've got Lindros. And the word I get is that the New York Islanders are more interested in defenseman Wade Redden of the Brandon Wheat Kings than they are in Chad Kilger from the Kingston Frontenacs.
Edmonton, it's great hockey fans and the Edmonton Oilers.
Tom Maloney with the sweater. Burt Marshall will make the announcement, the chief scout.
The Islander organization at this time is extremely proud and pleased to select Wade Redden from the Brandon Wheat Kings.
So a defenseman goes number two, Wade Redden. He is extremely poised, ice water in the veins. Some have described him in that manner. A very safe top pick. May not be a superstar, but he'll be steady for 10 or 15 years.
Well, just a terrific young man from Hillman, Saskatchewan, which isn't too far from the border, this province of Alberta, not too far from Lloydminster, the border town. Had just an outstanding season with the Brandon Wheat Kings. And as you said it, Paul, poise. There's nothing gets this kid ruffled at all. And they expected he'd be able to make the jump to professional hockey, not necessarily next year, and he's the first to admit that he may require further seasoning. but as a 17-year-old member of Canada's national junior team, he wasn't expected to make the team. He made it. He not only made it, but he asserted himself and played much better than did Brian Berard throughout that tournament. Berard is number one, though, because he's got more upside potential. He's got a bigger chance to be a more offensive star. Wade Redden doesn't do anything flashy, but he does everything well.
And note the new New York Islanders uniform, the new logo and the new color scheme.
A lot of controversy about the logo at first. Before anybody had seen it, everybody was worried that it was going to be a terrible-looking uniform. And then when it came out, people were sort of like pleasantly surprised that it didn't look as bad as a lot of people thought. There's his mother, Pat, a very proud mother today. A nurse from Hillmont, Saskatchewan.
First-round pick of the New York Islanders.
So defensemen 1 and 2, everything according to script so far. Berard number 1 and Wade Redden number 2.
The New York Islanders have had a long and good history taking Western Hockey League defensemen. Took Nolan Baumgartner from the Kamloops Blazers a year ago. Signed him, in fact, last night when they signed Brendan Witt. And now they've got Wade Redden, and here's the young man.
Well, Wade, first of all, congratulations. And is this somewhat of a relief now after all these years of good hard work?
Yeah, for sure. It's a step in the right direction. And you know, I'm really happy and honored to, you know, be part of the Islanders organization, and you know, hopefully we can do a lot of things in the next couple of years.
Were you pretty certain that you were going to go to the Islanders?
Well, it's tough to call. Like, they didn't give any indication. You know, they showed some interest, but you know, I'm just thrilled to death to be there.
Have a great career.
Thanks a lot.
The next selection, the third pick in the 1995 NHL entry draft, belongs to the Los Angeles Kings.
And do they go defense, or do they venture off the script and perhaps take a forward?
Well, if you look at the Los Angeles King team needs, they've got some good defensemen in Rob Blake and Daryl Sador. They could really use some help up front, but I'll tell you what, Paul, when you're at the top end of the draft, especially the top 3 or 4 spots, you cannot look at your team needs. You've got to look at who you think is the best player available. It's a cliche, but that is what the LA Kings really believe. They picked up Jamie Storr last year in the first round. He's expected to be a good one down the road. General manager Sam McMaster, enormous number of financial pressures and problems in the wake of Bruce McNall's situation in Los Angeles. Number one on the LA Kings list in terms of their talent search is the big Finnish defenseman Aki Petteri-Berg. So I don't think it's going to be any surprise at all when they take the big Finn on the blue line here. And again, a lot of people will say, well, why wouldn't you take a guy like Chad Kjelgaard, a big center? That's what they really need. But in the minds of the Los Angeles Kings scouts, they believe Aki Petteri-Berg is the best player available in this draft. They would, if they were picking number one overall, according to their scouting list, that's the player they would take. So I'll be very surprised if they don't do something here, although they may get a little offer here.
A player coveted by many, and there have been many rumors.
Very pleased to select from TPS in Finland, Aki Petteri-Berg.
Many rumors that they would trade, but they do not. They sit tight and take Aki Petteri-Berg, who prefers to be known as just Aki Berg. And Aki is the highest player ever taken from Finland in the NHL draft. Previously, it was Teemu Selänne, great forward with the Winnipeg Jets, who was taken 10th overall. Aki goes number 3, and there is just a ton of interest back in his hometown of Turku, Finland. They are pressed to the radio tonight. It's about 8:30 in Finland in the evening right now, hearing this news.
I was standing behind Aki in an interview yesterday, and I was just marveling at the size of this guy's back. He's like a skyscraper out there. He's one of the biggest, strongest defensemen or any player available in this draft. Scouts had limited viewing this year. Berg was very disappointed. He didn't get an opportunity to play for Finland at the World Junior Championships in Red Deer, Alberta. He sustained mononucleosis. He came back too early from that, had further complications, and really, in a lot of ways, it was a lost year. But what the scouts saw of him last summer at an international tournament in Mexico and in other tournaments since then, they like him very much. They think he's a great cross between Brian Berard and Wade Redden, and he might be more physical than either one of them. He's not quite as offensive as Berard, but he's more offensive than Wade Redden. And this is the year of the defenseman. 1, 2, 3, there they are. And the big Finn, who speaks very limited English, he's going to have to work on that. He's doing his military service, finishes it up at the end of August, and expects to be at the training camp of the Kings this fall.
Sam McMaster, we thought you might have gone for somebody up front. I guess this is the cliche coming into effect here, you take the best player available.
This player has been our number one player since he played in Lake Placid in August. We have not changed him on our list since that time. And if the whole purpose of the draft is to take the best player, then it's exactly right. And yes, you're right, we probably need some help, young players up front. But when we feel we've got a franchise defenseman and you just can't find those very easily, so it was very difficult for us not to take this player.
Now, if I can just shift gears here a little bit, who's going to coach your team?
Do you need a job?
Maybe after today, sure.
We haven't made our decisions yet. We've had three or four very good interviews, and hopefully we'll have an answer in a week.
Thanks, Sam.
You're welcome.
Big talk that Dave King, the bounced coach of the Calgary Flames, could end up
the next selection
coaching for the LA Kings.
I think King does have the inside track on the Kings' job, which Corin's also been interviewed for that job as well.
Anaheim has the fourth pick in the draft. By the way, the first time ever defensemen have gone 1-2-3 in the NHL draft.
David McNabb, the director of player personnel, along with Pierre Gauthier. They've got the slip of paper up with Brian Burke, senior vice president.
You get the slip? Well, 393 Anaheim picks played for the Ducks in 95, so they've done well by the draft in the very young history of the team.
They've obviously got some good talent, having drafted at the top Paul Kariya, taken a couple of years ago. Oleg Tverdovsky, the very fine Russian defenseman. They've got some Russian defensemen, Zuligin coming along, Antti-Aalto a center. What they would like ideally is some size up front, somebody to play along with Paul Kariya and help him out. And the obvious choice here is Chad Kilger of the Kingston Frontenacs, a big center, almost 6'4", 205 pounds. He's got some offensive ability, he's just a good two-way player. A lot of people compare him to a Ronnie Francis, maybe. Even a little bigger than that.
Mighty Ducks of Anaheim are very proud to select Chad Kilger from the Kingston Frontenacs. So Chad Kilger, the first forward taken in the draft, he's a centerman. And the big question with Chad is how much better can he get? Can he continue to build on the tremendous offensive potential people believe that he has? Is he going to be like Jason Arnott, the great young player for the Edmonton Oilers? Or maybe Ron Francis, the great veteran player?
Well, he had 42 goals this season, and that's a good indication that he's got some offensive ability with Kingston of the Ontario Hockey League. What they really like about him is his size, his strength, his work ethic, the fact that he will play physical. Comes from a hockey family. His dad, Bob Kilger, was a referee in the National Hockey League, played junior hockey, was a defense partner of Bobby Orr with the Oshawa Generals way back when. Bob Kilger has since gone on to federal politics. He's a deputy house leader with Jean Chrétien's Liberal government in Canada.
Do you see Chad maybe one day fitting in a line with Paul Kariya, tremendous smaller player for the Mighty Ducks?
Paul, it wouldn't surprise me in the least if Chad Kilger has to go back to Kingston for some seasoning next year. He's got an opportunity to play for the Ducks next year, but I don't think it should be carved in stone that a player this raw and with this raw talent will necessarily be in the NHL. But a fine pick for the Ducks, and I don't think there's any question that the ultimate plan is to have Chad Kilger playing on a line with Paul Kariya. Just a terrific young man. Intelligent, well-mannered, a real gentleman, except when he gets out on the ice and he plays with a real edge.
He's with Gary Green.
Chad, I've got to ask you this. When you were watching your father officiate, did you ever dream of playing in the National Hockey League?
I think as a young Canadian boy, that was always a goal of mine, to play National Hockey League, and now I get the opportunity to do that.
How much do you know about the Ducks? Have you been watching them this year?
Yeah, I had the opportunity to watch them a lot. Where I live, we have satellites, so I mean, it was a... I mean, this is a great place. I'm excited about playing there with players like Paul Kariya and Oleg Tverdovsky.
He's going to be one big Duck.
With the Ducks GM, Jack Ferreira, and Jack, this kind of works out well. You got a good guy up front. You already had Tverdovsky last year on the blue line.
Well, and Chad was second on our list, and he was the guy that we were hoping would slide, and it really depended upon how the first three defensemen went. And when they went 1-2-3, we were ecstatic.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
The next selection, the fifth pick in the 1995 NHL entry draft, belongs to the Tampa Bay Lightning.
Well, the Tampa Bay Lightning, they had all sorts of indecision at the table. They've obviously made up their mind now. Tony Esposito and Don Murdoch heading to the platform. I'll tell you what, they were having a big argument at the table before the draft started. They couldn't decide whether to take Damon Lankow, a very feisty, smallish center from the Tri-City Americans, or Steve Kelly, perhaps the fastest skater from the Prince Albert Raiders. But I'd be very shocked if they did not take one of those two offensive dynamos from the Canadian Hockey League.
They've jumped around in their first three drafts, taking a couple of defensemen and a centerman.
You say they said if we pick a center, there may be a place for him right now. Well, either Damon Lankow or Steve Kelly will challenge for a spot. Lankow is probably as ready as any player in this draft to step in and play next year. Kelly may need a little extra work. Jason Weimer coming off the broken ankle, played some games with the team last year, did a good job. Aaron Gavey, saw him a hero for Team Canada at the World Junior Championships.
Tyler Moss, a teammate of Chad Kilgers in Kingston, a great young goaltender.
Just signed right before the deadline yesterday. And Damon Lankow looks on. And this is his hometown. He'd like nothing better than to be going number 5 overall to the Tampa Bay Lightning.
The Tampa Bay Lightning proudly selects from the Western Hockey League Tri-City Americans, Damon Lankow.
Contingent here to cheer on Damon Lankow. This young man has racked up 223 points in his last 2 years in the Western Hockey League. There is some concern about his size, but only a little bit. He's tremendously creative up front.
He's very creative, and he's also very feisty. When he goes out on the ice, there's a very large chip on his shoulder, and I think a lot of that comes from being a smaller player. I talked to him when they brought these prospects into the Stanley Cup Final, and he says, hey, if I could be 6'4", I'd be 6'4", but I'm not. So I do the best that I can with what I've got, and I use it as a motivational tool. When I go out on the ice and I see a bigger player, I want to beat that guy. I figure I've got to prove myself that much more than a bigger player would. And he's obviously done that to the satisfaction of the Tampa Bay Lightning. This guy is destined to step in and play in their lineup next season.
People like to compare him to Jeff Friesen, who was an absolute steal in the draft. And as far as Mum is concerned,
yeah,
he's the first pick overall despite going number 5. Damon Lankow off to Tampa.
A first-round draft pick of the Tampa Bay Lightning, Damon Lankow.
Well, Terry Chris, the coach of the Tampa Bay Lightning, how much do you know, and first of all, did you expect to get Damon?
Well, we knew he was going to be one of the two guys we were looking at was young Damon Lankow. And we had the interview with him, Greener. You'd love this kid. I mean, we're liking him onto a Therrien Fleury, a Dougie Gilmore, and this kid is feisty. And when he had the interview, one thing he says, I'm coming to your camp to make your team, not just to show up.
Thanks, Crispy.
You got to like it, Greener.
Well, Damon Lankow, congratulations. You had a feeling it would be Tampa Bay. Where better to join the NHL than in your hometown?
No place. I mean, this is, right at home. And, I mean, as you can hear, I got a lot of friends and family up there. So, this is one of the most exciting days of my life.
You've always defended your size. And you feel you could be ready to jump into the NHL right away?
Yeah, I think so. With, I think Tampa Bay, they'll obviously give me, a good program, weight training and stuff like that. And, I think if I go to shape and go to camp in good shape, I think I should have a shot at making the team.
Congratulations once again.
Thanks a lot.
A 5 down and 21 to go in the first round of the 1995 NHL Draft. 3 defensemen, 1, 2, 3, and a couple of centermen. Number 1 overall, Brian Berard, off to Ottawa.
Why is that man beating up these kids?
Please don't anybody underestimate my commitment to this game.
Get inside the story with Dave Hodge. Inside Sports, weekdays on TSN.
The Memphis Mad Dogs. When did they name the team after Jeff Braswell? I'm Darren Attition, your host for CFL Live on TSN all this summer. The Mad Dogs.
Welcome back to the 1995 NHL Entry Draft on TSN and ESPN2. I'm Paul Romanek with Bob McKenzie, Gary Green, and Rod Smith on top of things down on the floor. And down on the floor, there is lots of discussion going on. Haven't seen
a trade yet during the draft. One consummated between Vancouver and Buffalo just prior to the draft.
Wow, the reason the fans are getting a little excitement here, Edmonton Oilers. Lots of talk about what the Edmonton Oilers have been trying to do. Talk about Bill Ranford being traded, Shane Corson. They're, of course, restricted free agents. But this pick is going to be taken by the Oilers. And they want some help up front, and they want some size, and they want some speed. And they can get either of those with Steve Kelly of the Prince Albert Raiders or Shane Doan of the Memorial Cup champion Kamloops Blazers. My guess is that they're going to go with Steve Kelly. The Edmonton Oilers were founded on speed. Glenn Sather, a big proponent of the high speed. Mats Lindgren coming into the system. He's a good Swedish forward.
Joaquin Gage, also a goaltender of the future, leading to speculation Bill Ranford might be traded.
And the fans here are yelling, Doan, Doan. They want Shane Doan from Memorial Cup champion Blazers. It will either be he or Steve Kelly. And I know the Oilers very high on the Prince Albert Raiders speedster.
So
the middle.
So the pick will stay in the Western Hockey League.
Not a big surprise. Glenn Sather's a big booster of Canadian Hockey League, a big booster of the Western League.
The Edmonton Oilers are proud to select from Prince Albert Raiders Steve Kelly.
The shouting was for Dome, but it's Steve Kelly, and they get a good one. Tremendous speed, likely the fastest skater available in this draft. They'd like him to finish a little better, although 72 points, no slouch.
You said it, Paul, outstanding speed. Bit of an upheaval in Prince Albert. They lost their coach, Don Clark, the older brother of Wendell Clark, to the bitter rivals, the Saskatoon Blades, and Steve Kelly and Brad Church, two of the Raiders that are eligible in this draft and to go high in the first round. We're lamenting the loss of their coach, Donnie Clark. And now Steve Kelly will get an opportunity to come and fly his trade with the Edmonton Oilers. Wouldn't be at all surprised if he's back in Prince Albert next year, but a speedy player who is, they would like to boost his natural offense just a little bit, show that he's got some real offensive flair.
Although, in fairness to Steve, he played in a team, Prince Albert, in the Western Hockey League of the Canadian Hockey League, with just tremendous depth up front. And as a result, he may not have gotten quite as much ice time as he would have, say, with another team in the West that wasn't quite as deep up front. 72 points, nothing to sneeze at, but still, when you're on a deep offensive team, that's going to hurt you a little.
Well, with me right now are Steve's biggest cheerleaders. I've got his little sister, Lisa, and Arthur. You pretty excited?
Yeah.
Were you cheering for your brother to go to this team?
Yeah. I was really glad he came to this team, because then we can travel all over the place and stuff.
Well, I'm pretty excited for you, too. Let's have a big cheer.
Steve, congratulations. A little mixed review there off the top, but I think they're warming up to you. How do you feel about coming to the Oilers?
It's great. I mean, especially right now, I mean, in front of the hometown fans. And, I mean, the organization, I guess, has been great for years. And, I mean, I'm just looking forward to staying in Canada and playing here.
Let me ask Glenn Sather. The scouts were saying this is the fastest guy available in the draft. Was it the speed that attracted you?
Well, I think that had a lot to do with it. We've built our teams around speed, and he's certainly got lots of that and character. So we're excited to have him.
Thanks. Congratulations.
You're welcome.
Hey, I wonder whether or not Glenn will be making a
the
deal.
The next selection,
day is over.
The seventh pick in the 1995 NHL entry draft belongs to the Winnipeg Jets.
Winnipeg Jets with pick number 7. Shane Doan would seem a logical selection. He was passed over by Edmonton.
Well, Paul, Jets general manager John Paddock ideally would like a defenseman, either Kyle McLaren or Jay McKee. Jay McKee from Niagara Falls. Kyle McLaren from the Tacoma Rockets have now moved to Kelowna. However, I don't think they really expected Shane Doan would be here. A lot of people thought Anaheim was going to take Shane Doan with the 4th pick, or that Edmonton might take him with the 6th pick. And now that he is, we should mention that Larry Corville, by the way, is no longer in the system. He's back in the draft today. He's one of those players who did not sign last night. A lot of uncertainty as to the future of the Winnipeg Jets organization. Jets president Barry Schenkerow. There's not much question the Jets will be in Winnipeg next year, but it's the long haul. Will the Spirit of Manitoba be able to put it together? If they do, Shane Doan, the MVP of the Memorial Cup, the Kamloops Blazers is expected to be in their lineup for an awfully long time.
And you saw the quote about personality of players being very important to our team. Shane Doan just blew teams away in the interview process. Just a class young man, and he really knocked his stock up in the opinion of many because of how well he did in the interview. There was some speculation the Islanders would take him because they were so impressed by the interview.
Here's Joe Iannetti with the announcement.
The Winnipeg Jets are proud to select from the Western Hockey League Memorial Cup champion Kamloops Blazers the Memorial Cup MVP, Shane Doan.
What a tremendous young man from Halkirk, Alberta. It's like this guy's got a red light on the top of his helmet that flashes around off the ice that says, I'm a good person. This guy is just a charming young man to be around. He's got outstanding skill as a hockey player. He's a big power forward in the Cam Neely mold. They'd like him maybe to have a shorter fuse, maybe burn his toast, but he's such a nice guy. His family runs a big ranch, this Circle Square Ranch in Halkirk, Alberta, which if you've ever watched television in Canada, 100 Huntley Street, a fundamental Christian religious program, own the ranch. His dad is the director of that ranch. A lot of people refer to the people from 100 Huntley as born-again Christians. Shane Doan wasn't born again because he's been part of the 100 Huntley family for the whole time.
He bounced back from knee surgery, had a solid year, the Memorial Cup MVP. A few concerns about his skating, but he is so strong on the puck. One scout called him the strongest kid in the draft, the toughest to move off the puck. And that's not something you can teach.
He's what they refer to as a horse, and he's just a big physical kid that likes to cut in off the wing and really do the job and go hard to the net. And you know, he talks about being a Christian, and he says, some people have a tough time reconciling how you can be so big on Christianity and still be part of hockey where there's so many violent aspects, the fighting, the sticks up and everything else. And he says, I've never really had a problem with that. His uncles, the Ellerbys, his dad, Bernie Doan, was a draft pick of the St. Louis Blues. They were all really tough hockey players. When he injured his knee, there's a look at Bernie right there, a proud moment for him. When he injured his knee a year ago and had to have reconstructive knee surgery, it was in a fight. And he says, hey, I got no problem with fighting in the way the game is played. Give it 100%, and that's just the way things are.
Mama just as soon he stayed away from the fights, though, probably, and kept the knees healthy for a long and successful NHL career, which will start with the Winnipeg Jets.
He's a great guy. He takes all the... Oh, he's with Gary Green now. Let's go to him.
Hey, Shane, first of all, congratulations. Were you surprised where you were selected?
Yeah, I was. I was surprised that I went that high, actually. I mean, there's so many great players in this draft. I was really lucky.
Well, they say that you like to run people over. Is that what you're planning on doing? And do you think you can play right away for Winnipeg?
I don't know. I mean, I know another year junior wouldn't hurt me, but at the same time, to learn from the best is the best. I mean, and the NHL's the best, and Winnipeg's a first-class organization. And so whatever the coaching staff decides, I'll be really happy with.
I'm sure you'll be ready.
I hope so.
John Paddock, did you think Shane Doan would still be around at 7?
No, we didn't. We thought very highly of him, and we didn't really have much hope that he'd be there, but we're absolutely thrilled to get him.
You've denied that you're trying to build with a little bit of homegrown talent to balance out the Europeans. Just the same, how well does this work out for Winnipeg?
Well, it works out very well in the fact that he's a big horse of a winger, and we were looking for defenseman, but if the best player there, we would take him. And we think he has a chance to grow into be something not too far off Keith Tkachuk, and that thrills us.
Thanks, John.
Thank you.
So defensemen go 1, 2, and 3 as projected, but since then, centerman, a right winger, and I would bet the next pick will also be a forward, that next pick held by the Montreal Canadiens.
The next selection, the 8th pick in the 1995 NHL entry draft, belongs to the Montreal Canadiens.
Just before we talk about the Habs, Paul, go back to the Winnipeg Jets. Lots to talk about their future. Tamu Solani up on the block. They would like to sign him, all things being equal, but it's going to be awfully difficult with the payroll being the way it is. So Solani is a guy who could well be on the move, if not today, then in the ensuing weeks over the course of the summer.
Now, the Montreal Canadiens, as we mentioned, likely going up front. They need offense. A team that has thrived on defensive hockey and really run out of gas when you get into needing scoring, which is often in the playoffs.
We saw in the playoffs that the Montreal Canadiens were just too small. They were physically inadequate. Well, I'm sorry, we didn't see in the playoffs because they didn't make the playoffs. But they're going to add Saku Koivu, who's a great offensive player, but he's very small up front. David Wilkie on defense. Marco Kiprusoff, a good Finnish defenseman, will also be challenging to be in the lineup next year. I talked to Andre Boudria before this draft, and he says, we really want to try to increase our size and strength factor. And if you're going to do that, and you're going to do it up front, where the Montreal Canadiens' needs are the greatest at this point, the two players that you're going to look at are a Czech player, Radek Dvorak, a big winger center who can play either position, big, strong, power forward type, or Terry Ryan from Mount Pearl, Newfoundland, who plays for Tri-City of the Western Hockey League. A terrific story there, which we'll get into later. But that's the decision the Montreal Canadiens are faced with right now. My instincts tell me that Radek Dvorak would be the guy that they want. Some people favor Dvorak as a bit of a long shot, as maybe the best player in the draft, a guy who could well be the best.
To select from the Tri-City, Terry Ryan.
Terry Ryan is the man. He's big, 6'1", 207 pounds. He had 207 penalty minutes.
This kid is a remarkable story, and I know they're all excited back at the Don Cherry's restaurant there in downtown St. John's. All the folks out watching this game watching this draft on TV. Terry Ryan Jr. got a big hug from Terry Ryan Sr., and this kid at the age of 14 left his home in Newfoundland and moved all the way across to Quesnel, BC. He played as a 14-year-old in the Rocky Mountain Junior League. This guy's a 20 or 21. In the very first game he played, there was a huge bench-clearing brawl, and he got beat up and beat up bad, and that showed the kind of determination that he had to stay on and become a star scorer with the Tri-City Americans. The knock on Terry Ryan as a hockey player is that he's not a very good skater. He has a tough time getting around, but he overcomes that with grit, desire, and just an abounding desire to get the job done. He's a good goal scorer, he's a good fighter, he's a good body checker. He's going to be a big man for the Montreal Canadiens many years to come.
I'm with Mr. and Mrs. Ryan. First of all, congratulations. Hey, I've got a love story going on here. You've got to be pretty happy.
I'm lost for words, particularly, you know, if you're in Newfoundland, it seems like you're Toronto, you're a Montreal fan, and I had no idea at all he was going to Montreal. I'm lost.
That was a pretty big sacrifice, moving at he was 14 years of age, he left home and went to the BC.
Yeah, but it's well worth it now.
Well, congratulations.
I just want to tell you, it's our 23rd wedding anniversary, too.
The 23rd wedding anniversary, no wonder I've got a love story here.
Thank you.
And congrats to the family, and you talk about making sacrifices.
Terry, you move across the country at age 14, pursuing a dream. Is this the dream day?
This is definitely the dream day. I can't believe it. I mean, I'm in shock. It hasn't kicked in yet. I mean, this is the day I've been waiting for since I started playing hockey, and it's just unbelievable. I mean, I thank everybody along the way, my parents, my friends, everybody. This is just unbelievable.
And you're in the top 10 with your buddy Damon Lankow. What has he meant to you working together in Tri-City?
Damon actually is a great friend and a great line mate. I mean, he's helped me this year. I mean, I had a so-so year when I was 16, and this year he's just, you know, he's been there for me. We're going through the same thing, same situation, and it's great. He's just a great, great person. I enjoy him, and, you know, he's helped me a lot.
All the best.
Thanks. Can I say hello to someone at home?
Go ahead.
I have to say hello to Baz. He told me for sure to say hello to him, so hi, Baz. Okay.
Hey, you reap what you sow, and today the harvest is a bountiful one for Terry Ryan as he realizes his dream of going in the first round of the NHL draft. The first three picks, all defensemen. Since then, the forwards are running the show. More still to come.
What's so new about New Speed Stick Clear deodorant?
Take a look at this gel. See? It's wet and sticky. And mine, it goes on dry.
New Speed Stick Clear. It's more than clear. It's clearly dry.
By Menon.
Hey, I'll take dry any day.
Looking for the inside scoop on Big League Baseball? Join Dan Shulman and Buck Martinez for the Major Leagues Today. Inside an opinion about the boys of summer. The Major Leagues Today. Catch it weekdays on a TSN sports radio station near you.
The great men of baseball are at the very heart of the game. They're the ones who set the standards, the ones who create the memories. They take us to new heights. They allow us to dream. Join TSN for the lead up to the Midsummer Classic. First, the Heroes of Baseball All-Star Game, followed by the popular home run hitting contest. Then cap the night with a star-studded gala. It's All-Star Monday, right here on Real TV, TSN.
Welcome back to Edmonton, Alberta. Viewers on ESPN2 and on TSN as the 1995 NHL Entry Draft continues.
The next selection, the ninth pick in the 1995 NHL Entry Draft, belongs to the Boston Bruins.
Well, Paul, the Boston Bruins have two picks in this first round. This pick actually belongs to the Hartford Whalers. It was part of the Glenn Wesley deal. They have a pick later in the round, number 21 overall. Gordy Clark coming up with a sweater along with assistant GM Mike O'Connell.
Well, last year the Boston Bruins took a Russian-born goaltender in the first round, Yevgeny Rabshchikov. Will they go overseas again? Radek Dvorak is still there.
I don't think so. In fact, I think they're going to go with a big defenseman from the Tacoma Rockets, now in Kelowna, Kyle McLaren. One of the biggest players in the draft, being compared to Larry Robinson at times.
And a defenseman. Kyle would be the first defenseman taken since the first three picks in what they're calling the year of the defenseman.
Well, the Boston Bruins are old at a lot of key positions. Ray Bourque's not getting any younger. Adam Oates, Cam Neely, a lot of Cam Neely trade rumors. So you could go either defense or forward, and you'd be addressing a need.
Boston Bruins select from Kelowna, the WHL, Kyle McLaren.
Kyle McLaren, a defenseman, is their man. And in a year of top D-men, he slipped out of the top five, but didn't drop all that far. He broke his wrist five games into the season, only played 47 games, thus hampering the numbers somewhat.
Hampered the numbers, but it never actually hampered his ratings because the injury came in the first half of the season. And when that happens, you've got the second half to build yourself back up in the eyes of the scouts, and he did that with really solid two-way play. He's a mountain of a man, represented by Paul Messier, the brother of Mark Messier.
He's 6'4", 210 pounds. Fair to say, though, that he's more of an unknown quantity than Berg, Redden, or Berard, the big three?
A little more, and sometimes that can work for you. You know, there was a lot of scouts who said, well, I like him better than Redden, or I like him better than Berg, and one of the reasons they say that is because they haven't watched him as much. The more scouts watch a player, the more they find wrong with him. So sometimes it can almost be to your advantage if you're injured early in the season, as the second half of the season. If you play reasonably well in the second half, you don't get quite as intense scrutiny as some of the other players do who've been on display for 75 or 80 games. But a big day for the folks from Coaldale, Alberta. Big Kyle McLaren.
The Boston Bruins.
Joins the Boston
first
Bruins.
First round selection, Kyle McLaren.
And a big dominating defenseman, the Bruins hope.
Well, Kyle, first of all, congratulations. I want to know what your parents fed you in Coaldale, Alberta.
Oh, just fed me a lot of food. Just, I could eat anything in the house, so it's just, I'm very grateful for him, and I'm glad to be part of Boston.
Well, first of all, the Bruins haven't exactly been big and bad lately. Are you planning on making them that way?
Hopefully, I hope I can step up and hopefully play in a couple years or whatever. Just hopefully I can help the team a little bit.
Well, congratulations, and good luck in Boston.
Thanks.
Now the Boston Bruins get themselves a big one. 6'4", 210 pounds, and boy, I'll tell you, he hasn't even finished growing yet, Paul.
The 10th selection in the 1995 NHL entry draft belongs to the Florida Panthers.
Radek Dvorak still there and available. Does he go here?
Two very good offensive Czech players. Radek Dvorak, who played in the Czech Republic this year, and Peter Sikora from the Detroit Vipers. Two very fine hockey players. You know, I think that the Florida Panthers were a little surprised, or are a little surprised at this point, that the top five defensemen haven't gone. Four of the top five defensemen haven't gone. And although their preference would be for a forward, I think they're a little surprised that Jay McKee from the Niagara Falls Thunder is still there. He took Ed Jovanovski with the first pick overall last year. Steve Washburn, a center from the Ottawa 67s. General manager Brian Murray, who's in search of a coach to coach his hockey team, goes up to the podium along with John Chapman, the chief scout.
I'm surprised Peter Sikora hasn't gone yet.
Well, I know that in the minds of the Panthers, they were looking at a situation where they might have to decide between Dvorak and Sikora with this pick. But it complicates things now that Jay McKee is still available. And it wouldn't surprise me in the least if they break from the mold and go after a guy like Jay McKee, although Brian Murray seems to be a little uncertain here as to what the next move is, and I'll let the pictures tell the story here for a moment as they check with the National Hockey League.
And I wonder if there's a deal brewing. Dvorak and Sikora, both forwards, both centermen. Jay McKee is a defenseman. And it appears as though they're going to make their pick.
Yeah, Greg Burris, director of public relations, comes up, hands the sweater off to Brian Murray. People speculating as to who the coach might be of the Florida Panthers. There's a decent chance, or a fair chance, that it could be Doug McLean, who's been Murray's right-hand man for years. And here's John Chapman with the announcement. Should be Jay McKee,
before,
but it could be one of the two check
Panthers
forwards.
Make their selection, we'd like to acknowledge the thousands of people in Broward County Convention Center in Florida that are taking part in the special day of the 1995 draft. We'd like to say hello to them. Florida Panthers are pleased to make their selection from Czechoslovakia, Radek Dvorak.
Radek Dvorak, 6'1", 175-pound centerman, did not play in a tournament that is really a launching pad and a big display case for an awful lot of great young junior players, the World Junior Championship. He didn't play because he had a broken wrist.
Well, we've had two picks in a row now, Kyle McLaren and Radek Dvorak, who had broken wrists that limited their viewing. And unlike the North American players, there are less opportunities for the international stage for players like Radek Dvorak. 2 years ago at Amos, Quebec, at the Under-18 World Championship, Radek Dvorak was there, and he was without question the best player of all the players that were there. General Manager Sam McMaster of the Los Angeles Kings was at that tournament as a member of the Team Ontario team at the time when he was with the Sudbury Wolves. He says, this kid is unbelievable. They were giving some serious thought to Dvorak at number 3 overall. It's got to be an exciting day. We talk about this as the grassroots level of hockey. Well, think about it for the Czech Republic as well, to come all this way and see all the attention focused on the entry draft and on their son, Radek Dvorak.
Ludovici in the Czech Republic is where Radek is from, or where he played, and he tries on the Florida jersey. His stock kind of went up and down. Didn't play in the World Junior Championship, came back and was great at the Four Nations tournament in February, and then he was kind of average again in April at the European Junior Championship. But put all that aside, it's a great day for the family and for him to finally get this over with. The pressure is off.
Well, for some of the scouts that saw him at the last tournament at the European Junior Championships in April, he played terrible and were scared right off him. This kid could well be one of the big, strong, powerful guys that could turn out to be one of the top two or three players available in the draft. I'm not going to say there's a bias against European players because we've seen so many of them over the years that you couldn't really make that statement and back it up with any facts. But at the same time, there's still a bit of a hesitation. All things being equal, if you've got a North American player or you've got a Czech or a Russian and you've got them on equal footing, most teams will opt for that player. But in this case, the Florida Panthers had a choice between two very good Czech players, Sikora and Dvorak.
Brian Murray, it seems like scouts had mixed feelings on Dvorak. Was there any uncertainty really to get over to draft him?
Not really. He's a real good player, good forward, a right-hand shot, play left wing, scored some goals, and obviously in Florida, that's at this time what we're looking for.
If I could also ask you about the coaching situation with the Panthers.
Well, there's nothing at this point. We're interviewing a good number of people, and hopefully as we get past the draft and we get a chance to really focus, we'll make a decision within a week or two.
Thanks, Brian.
Thank you.
Sure.
So Radek Dvorak, a member of the Florida Panthers. And again, one of those question marks. Like Peter Sikora, whose stock has dropped down. We haven't seen Sikora go yet. Will he go next? It is Dallas on deck.
Well, we talked about injuries and how they impact on your year. Peter Sikora suffered the misfortune of a shoulder separation in the middle of the year and did not play for the balance of the year. That's the worst time to get an injury.
The 11th selection in the 1995 NHL entry draft.
They were able to bounce back and show what they could do. Peter Sikora didn't get that opportunity. The book on the Dallas Stars going into this pick was that they would have liked to get Terry Ryan. He's a guy that they interviewed a lot. They like big, strong, physical two-way players to play for Coach Bob Gainey's team. There's a guy sort of like that from the Kamloops Blazers. Jerome Iginla is another player that they like. It'll be interesting to see if they waver at all when they have a guy like Sikora available that otherwise might not have been there.
Brad Church, also another big, strong forward from Prince Albert in the Western Hockey League. Jay McKee, the defenseman, is still in there. You take a look at the Dallas system. Jamie Langenbrunner, high hopes for him. Big, strong centerman. Emmanuel Fernandez,
had a solid year in goal, hoping he can crack the big club next year. And Bob Gainey will not be coaching this year. There is a lot of speculation that he is going to kick himself upstairs. That's not carved in stone, but he would rather not coach. He would rather be a full-time GM, but again, that's just the talk.
I'll believe that one when I see it.
Why?
Because coaching's in his blood, and I think that's what he wants to do. It's a difficult, difficult job. He's obviously gone through a very difficult time of late with the passing away of his wife, Kathy, just a couple of weeks ago. Obviously, a very difficult time for Bob Gainey, but such a strong individual on and off the ice, a Hall of Famer with the Montreal Canadiens. Now guiding the fortunes of the Dallas Stars.
Don Hay, the coach of the Kamloops Blazers, the Memorial Cup champions, rumored to maybe be going to Dallas as a head coach.
Aguinla.
And you're going to get a look at one of his players, Jerome Aguinla, who played for the Kamloops Blazers, selected by the Dallas Stars.
Aguinla, a very strong two-way hockey player, and he's obviously a winner. Here's a kid, his first 2 years in major junior hockey, has the good fortune of going to an organization like the Kamloops Blazers and comes away with not one, but two Memorial Cup rings. Most players go through junior hockey, they never win a Memorial Cup. This guy's won two in his first 2 years in the league. Just a remarkable accomplishment for a guy that can really do a lot of things on the ice.
So he goes 11th overall and comes from an organization that has just produced great hockey player after great hockey player, the most dominant organization in Canadian junior hockey, Memorial Cup champions in three of the last 4 years. Jerome has been a part of two of those teams. And that trademark, the Kamloops trademark, is a heck of a stamp to have in your resume.
Well, he had 33 goals and 71 points, 111 penalty minutes and 72 games with the Blazers. He's a very popular selection because he's from nearby St. Albert, Alberta. Suburb of Edmonton.
And his family front row center to watch this great moment for him.
Very strong on the puck. Those are the assets that he brings to the game. Some people have questioned his skating just a little bit, but not enough that will prevent him from playing in the National Hockey League. And just great, great character, as all those players from the Blazers distilled over the years by the various coaches and general manager Bob Brown, who has since departed from the scene. Now with the Tri-City Americans, incidentally. Maybe a new dynasty in the making there for Bob Brown, but for now, Jerome Aguinla picks up his Dallas Stars jersey. He's with our Rod Smith.
And Jerome, congratulations. Tell me not only what it's like being drafted, but with so many people cheering you on, being from Edmonton.
Well, it was great. It was pretty anxious in the crowd there, that you could feel the tension around. I didn't expect to be picked here. It was just an unbelievable feeling.
You're known for your versatility. I think that's why Bob Gainey went for you.
I don't know. I hear that's what I'm known for. I don't know. I really don't know what to expect.
Congratulations once again.
Thanks a lot.
You know, sometimes you don't have to say all that much, and the message comes through loud and clear. We are through 11 picks in the 1995 NHL Entry Draft. Ryan Berard, number one overall, pick number 12, upcoming.
Inside every one of us is an athlete with a thirst for the game going on around us. It's life. And if you play hard at it, you get thirsty. That's why we make Gatorade. Hey, life is a sport. Drink it up.
Breaking down for the second and a half in.
Round eight of the 1995 Formula One World Championship. Don't miss the roar of the engines from Silverstone, England. An informative pre-race show ignites the excitement, followed by the green light, live Sunday morning, July 16th. The British Grand Prix, the wheels are turning on Real TV TSN.
Welcome back to coverage of the 1995 NHL Entry Draft on TSN and ESPN2. San Jose coming up.
The 12th selection in the 1995 NHL Entry Draft belongs to the San Jose Sharks.
Peter Segura is still out there. Jay McKee as well.
Right now, Paul, those are the two players that probably a lot of people expected would have been gone. Detroit Viper center Peter Segura and Niagara Falls Thunder defenseman Jay McKee, and I'm sure both will be considerations for the talent-laden San Jose Sharks, a team that is on the rise.
By the way, Michael Segura, not to be confused with the Peter Segura, who is available in the draft. Michael is not. But certainly no hesitation in going the European route.
Oh, no. Good deal of the early success of the San Jose Sharks has been founded on European hockey players. Not necessarily any guarantee they'll go that way this time. They would really like most teams in the National Hockey League, given the strength of the New Jersey Devils and others, to build up that size and strength factor, and quite often that ends up having to take players from this side of the Atlantic. So I would think McKee would be a consideration on defense. Brad Church, a left winger with the Prince Albert Raiders, a prototypical pro-style forward, will also be the kind of guy that they're looking at. They took Jeff Friesen last year with the 11th pick, and I'll tell you what, they figure he was a steal there, and they might get one.
They would like to dedicate this first pick to a good friend that we lost this year, Larry Ross. San Jose selects with its first pick in the 1995 entry draft from Espoo, Finland, Timo Riihijärvi.
They do it every year, Paul. They throw you the name out of left field. Timo Riihijärvi, a big Finnish left winger, and this guy is big. He's about 6'5" or 6'6". And he's a guy that a lot of people thought would go late in the first round, maybe early in the second round, but the San Jose Sharks, they love to mix it up and throw it at you a little bit differently. And Dean Lombardi, the general manager, did exactly that.
Just a tremendous scouting staff the San Jose Sharks have. I mean, they're a team that it's hard to do in this era, like it is in any sport, but combing the bushes, looking for that dark horse. They may have found one with Riihijärvi. Tremendous size for a winger. And he can really dominate out there when he gets it cranked up because of his size and because of his reach. But you talked about the steal last year with Jeff Friesen when they picked him up. A lot of people didn't think Friesen would go at that point in the draft. San Jose took a chance, and it turned out to be no chance whatsoever.
Well, you can always tell the San Jose scouts at the arena because they're the guys all with their laptop computers all lined up, and they've taken scouting to a new scientific level. And some people would suggest today that they've taken it right off the map, that this is a guy that they definitely could have had in the second round. The Hockey News Draft Preview had him rated number 31 overall.
He's one of those guys where you hear the words interesting and enigma and challenge and puzzle when they talk about him. A bit of an unknown quantity. But the Sharks feeling that they know enough about this young man to make him their first round pick.
Well, I talked about them wanting to get bigger. 6'6" would be a lot bigger than just about anybody else in this draft. I said most of the time you have to come to this side of the Atlantic to get a big boy. While Riihijärvi, 6'6" and 202 pounds, and obviously some filling out still to do, put on another 15 pounds or so, he's going to be a monster out there. And when you start looking at Viktor Kozlov, the big guy that they've got there, and Mike Rathje on defense, and Michael Segura, they are going to be a very, very, very big hockey team.
Hey, so crack out the laptops and start combing through the program to find the next dark horse for the next round.
Well, I'm with Dean Lombardi right now, and you've surprised the guys in the booth.
Well, I don't know if it was that much of a surprise, Gary. I think a lot of people might have liked this guy in the late middle or late first round, and we don't think he would have been there in the second round. We get a guy with this type of size, and he's got a mean streak. We figured we better jump on him now.
I mean, you mentioned size. I mean, your team is absolutely huge now. Is that obviously something you've been concentrating on, focusing on?
Yeah, I think you can see a trend there with Kozlov and Nazarov and Rathje and Segura, but it's self-evident when you watch the Stanley Cup playoffs of teams that succeed. You got to be able to play, but that rink's getting smaller all the time, so we're just trying to keep up with the Joneses.
And interviews for me are getting tougher. Thanks.
Hey, well, late first round, a big difference between late first round and 12th in the first round. That is early mid first round.
Well, Riihijärvi, what they like about him is that he does use his size to advantage. He's not a gentle giant in an international tournament. The scouts went to see him. He got kicked out of the final game. He cross-checked a Czech player in the head, was threatening to drop the gloves and go a little bit ballistic out on the ice. And the scouts obviously perk up their ears and their eyes when they see a player.
In the 1995 NHL entry draft,
Hartford Whalers selecting
Hartford Whalers.
Well, I'm sure the Hartford Whalers are a little surprised right now. There's been some players that haven't been taken. Jay McKee, Michael Segura. They've also got some high interest in the goaltender, Martin Bira, from the Beauport Harfang. So some interesting selections here for the Whalers.
It's Coach Paul Holmgren there on the right.
They'd like to get some goal scoring. That's obviously the weakness of a Hartford Whaler team. So many games that they're in, they just lose the game because they don't have enough guns. But their goaltending is getting...
I like the way Jim Rutherford plays it down there. Wow, the first round's all overrated. That's why we took Chris Pronger last year, who ended up making the team. Jeff O'Neill, another highly touted first rounder. Seems to me they're doing well. We're just going to peek and see. And it looks as though a goaltender's name is going down. If I'm reading that correctly, it looks as though it is Jean-Sébastien Giguère.
That's right.
From the Quebec Major Junior Hockey League, who wasn't the highest-rated goaltender heading into this draft.
No, he wasn't. Martin Biron was number one on NHL Central Scouting, but there were more than a handful of teams that believe Jean-Sébastien Giguère is the better prospect. Biron is a big, tall, skinny guy, 6'3", 150-odd pounds, with more of a stand-up style. Giguère is more of the classic Quebec League guy, like Felix Potvin, who gets down and uses that big paddle. Patrick Wagner down into the butterfly, spends more time on the ice.
Well, in the head-to-head battle between Giguère and Biron in the playoffs in the Quebec Major Junior Hockey League, it was Giguère who won that battle and took his team into the next round.
Well, you figure if anybody knows anything about goaltenders, might be Jimmy Rutherford, who played for many years in the National Hockey League, chiefly with the Detroit Red Wings, former Detroit Junior Red Wing.
Of course, we had the selection made. He could pull a fast one.
Yeah, right. They pull another one out of the pocket just to make us look bad. But Peter Karmanis, the owner of the Whalers, goes up with Jim Rutherford. They, of course, own the Detroit Junior team. They've had to change the name from the Junior Red Wings to the Junior Whalers.
Select Jean-Sébastien Giguère.
And it is Jean-Sébastien Giguère. No fast one pulled at the last moment. He's a classic butterfly goaltender, as Bob just mentioned. And he had a great second half and a very good playoff, which really increased his stock. Played with, and here's one of the great team names of all time, the Halifax Mooseheads. And yes, they are sponsored by the brewery of the same name.
Absolutely. Patterns his style after Patrick Roy and really turned the heads of a lot of scouts. At the beginning of the year, he was rated as the top goaltender coming in. He was the top goaltender picked in the midget draft. But as the season went along, he was eclipsed a little bit by Martin Biron. But then in the playoffs, he reasserted himself, and there was more than one team, more than the Hartford Whalers, believed Giguère was the best goaltender available in this year's draft.
The Mooseheads, an expansion team. The goals against average, very respectable in the Quebec Major Junior Hockey League, which is a fairly offensive league. The goals against average under 4, again with a first-year team, although you really see the expansion aspect come into play in a one-loss record. He was 14-27-5. But Jean-Sébastien Giguère, the first goaltender taken in this 1995 NHL entry draft, off to Hartford.
Well, the Hartford Whalers have Sean Burke in net as their number one goaltender, but he's starting to get a little on in years. Boy, does it make you feel old when Sean Burke, a guy we used to watch play for the Toronto Marlies, and we're talking about how he's getting on in years. They don't have an ace young goaltender in the system. Manny Legacy is a guy who might be able to come up and do the job in the National Hockey League for them. They want to get one of those top guys. The goaltending factory out of Quebec continues. Martin Brodeur, Felix Potvin, Patrick Roy, Stephane Fissette, Jocelyn Thibault. The list goes on, and now add Jean-Sébastien Giguère.
And Giguère, like his hero, Patrick Roy of the Montreal Canadiens, a student of the great goaltending tutor, François Allaire. And the place packed, about 14,000 here, and a lot of family members, family and friends. This family coming all the way from Quebec.
Not surprising at all that the first player taken from the Quebec Major Junior Hockey League, a goaltender.
Problem with the microphone there. We'll try to get it straightened out. That was Jimmy Rutherford, who Rod Smith was attempting to chat with. Jimmy, as you mentioned, Bob, a former goaltender himself, so a guy with a pretty keen eye for goaltending talent. So we are working our way through the first round. Giguère, the first goaltender taken. He goes 13th overall. Pick number 14 belonging to Vancouver when we come back.
Yeah, I took the High Endurance Challenge from Old Spice because I didn't really think it could work better than my old deodorant. But it does. It evaporates less quickly. It also lasts longer, protects better against odor. Now you got proof. Guaranteed.
Now it's time for your favorite snack. McCain! Peach Pocket!
this. McCain captures perfect pizza taste in a pocket, ready for that first bite.
Now's the time for your favorite snack.
Perfect pizza taste in a crust that's baked, not fried. So there's no leaks, no mess, just taste.
McCain! Pizza pockets.
Just perfect pizza taste.
After the game, in front of the press, white hair has to look great, and great hair can't have flakes. So I get rid of them with Head & Shoulders. It keeps my dandruff in check, and my hair looking great.
Head & Shoulders, every day.
Because great hair can't have flakes.
We see one of the drivers getting into the car, apparently. Another 103 left.
Get revved with the explosive Players Limited IndyCar Racing Series. Motor Madness invades the Midwest for the Texaco Javelin Grand Prix. Live Sunday afternoon from Elkhart Lake, Wisconsin. The wheels are turning right here on Real TV, TSN.
Because you're going to wear them until you break 90, Micotin penetrates the skin to kill athlete's foot.
Busy day on TSN. Hope you're enjoying live coverage of the 1995 entry draft. Coming up, however, Toronto Blue Jays going up against the Oakland A's. Residents of Ontario will see both halves of that doubleheader. Elsewhere in the country, sports desk. So the next pick belonging to the Vancouver Canucks. Hold it just a second. It did at the start of the day, but they made that deal with the Buffalo Sabres. Alexander McGillney, in case you haven't heard, Alexander McGillney going from Buffalo to the Vancouver Canucks, along with a fifth round pick. Mike Pekka, Mike Wilson, and Vancouver's first round pick. This one, 14th overall, going the other way.
The 14th selection in the 1995 NHL entry draft.
Played for the Ottawa 67s. Mike Wilson is a 6'6" defenseman with the Sudbury Wolves. Still a bit of a project. Some interesting choices here. I'd be hard pressed to think that the Buffalo Sabres could go buy a player like Niagara Falls Thunder defenseman Jay McKee or a center like Peter Sikora. Two players that I'm sure just about anybody would have figured would be long gone by now, but the drafting of Teemu Rea-Harvey by the San Jose Sharks and Jerome Iginla by the Dallas Stars has probably shaken things up just a little bit.
Buffalo, by the way, will not have Dale Hawerchuk, great veteran player in their lineup next year. He's signed a deal with the St. Louis Blues, so they have that void to fill. Three-year deal worth about $2.5 million per year.
You talk about filling the void, maybe Wayne Primo will fill that void, if not now, if not immediately. The younger brother of Keith Primo is going to be a good hockey player, a big, strong, physical center. Could step in and fulfill some of that void created by the loss of Dale Hawerchuk. Curtis Brown, big scorer from the Western Hockey League, Moose Jaw Warriors.
And for Detroit fans, how similar would Wayne's style be to that of Keith, his older brother?
Very similar, maybe not as offensively flashy as Keith can sometimes be, but he's a big, strong, physical kid who likes to hit, and he's going to be a player.
I can't believe Peter Sikora hasn't gone yet. We'll see if this is the pick.
Buffalo Sabres selecting Niagara Falls Thunder, Jay McKee.
It's Jay McKee, a defenseman from the Niagara Falls Thunder. The Niagara Frontier, right in the Buffalo neck of the woods.
Well, he won't have to go very far. It's about a 10-minute drive from where he, well, probably 15-minute drive from the arena in Niagara Falls to Memorial Auditorium. Memorial Auditorium soon to be taken over by the Crossroads Arena, and Jay McKee will help try to fill that for the Buffalo Sabres. A guy who, until he was traded from the Sudbury Wolves to the Niagara Falls Thunder in midseason in a big trade in the OHL that brought Jason Bonsignor and Ethan Morrow to the Sudbury Wolves, really didn't get a lot of ice time. I talked to him yesterday. He says, you know, I didn't have a lot of confidence. The only time I got on the ice, I ended up fighting. I really didn't feel as though I had a role, and if I made a mistake, I felt like I wasn't going to be back out on the ice. Well, the trade changed all that. He went to Niagara Falls. He became an assistant captain. He took a leadership role, and he rocketed up the scouting
And right. Just to play the devil's advocate, though, does a solid half season all of a sudden make him a good offensive defenseman? I mean, he was in junior C hockey only a couple of years ago. That's where his parents were watching him play. Today they're watching him up there being a first-round pick.
Well, this is very much like the Kyle MacLaren story. Is you're not seen very much in the first half of the season. You're seen a lot in the second half, but only for a short period of time. doesn't give the scouts as much time to find as many things wrong with you. But Jay McKee, a very solid two-way defenseman. He can play the physical game. He can take care of business at own end, but he doesn't mind picking up the puck and going with it. He's got the skill, the mobility, and the puck handling skills to be able to do that.
Jay, talking to you yesterday, I knew there were a number of possibilities you thought about. I don't think the Sabres was one of them, though.
No, actually, I hadn't talked to the Sabres much, but you know, it was, the year went well for me, and this is great. It's a great way to end it off.
You were skyrocketing by the scouts. I think you thought you'd be in the top 10. Is this a little disappointing not going in the top 10?
Oh, it's not disappointing at all. You know, top 10 was talked about, but I had a range about 10 to 15, and you know, this is great. This is great.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Player, the general manager of the Buffalo Sabres, you looking for size?
Yes, that's what we're looking for, and that gives us two pretty big defensemen on the Vancouver trade. We get McKee, and we get Wilson same time. Wilson's 6'4", so we're turning our hockey club around.
You've got you've made a trade today. How are you going to replace the goals from McGillney?
Well, I don't think we can do that. We're going in a different direction in Vancouver. Vancouver is very close to winning a Stanley Cup, and I think Alex McGillney is a great addition for them. And the players that we receive from Vancouver will be a great addition for us. We're trying to rebuild our hockey club. We're in transition, so we both have got what we wanted.
Okay, you've got another pick coming up in one more. So who are you looking for?
Well, I don't really know. I'll wait and see what Toronto picks, and then we'll decide.
Good luck, John.
Thank you.
Now the Buffalo Sabres will be back at the podium in two picks. Next up, though, we'll let Gary Bettman tell you.
The 15th selection in the 1995 NHL entry draft belongs to the Toronto Maple Leafs.
General manager Cliff Fletcher has been a very busy man. He hasn't consummated anything here, though, at least coming into the draft had not. He's talked about a number of different things, and I wonder if the presence of Peter Sikora being there will change the plan. And I'll be honest with you, I think it has. Well, Peter Sikora or defenseman Jeff Ware are two players that they really like. There's also a Russian winger, Alexei Morozov.
Yeah, but there was some speculation. Some people I talked to indicated to me that the Leafs did not want to draft a European player. They wanted to draft a North American player.
With the exception of Sikora, if he fell that far. They didn't anticipate it. Daryl Sittler watches on. But Cliff Fletcher also talked a lot about trading down this pick. If somebody else wanted the pick, he was going to move into the second round, and he was going to pick up a defenseman who could help him. Cliff Fletcher's mission here at the draft is not necessarily to go home with a young prospect that is going to be good in two or three or four years. His mission for Coach Pat Burns is to get some defensemen that can play. And he's hoping to come out of this weekend maybe with one or two guys that can classify as number three or number four defensemen to play on the Toronto blue line.
They're expecting Brandon Convery to step in next year. They're hoping anyways.
Zdeněk Nedved has done a good job. May not be quite ready to step into the lineup, but down the line. And Frederick Modine, a guy who they picked up in the third round last year. They traded their second round pick so they could get a third rounder from the New York Islanders, a big Swedish player. He's still a ways away. But the fact that they've got the sweater up there indicates that they're not trading down. If they're not trading down, then I believe that Peter Sikora would be their first choice, although the two players that they were contemplating taking with that 15th pick were Jeff Ware, the big defenseman from the Oshawa Generals, and Alexei Morozov, a very gifted, skilled right winger from Moscow Dynamo, or rather the Moscow Wings.
Well, again, the speculation was they wanted to stay in North America for the pick.
Toronto Maple Leafs are proud to select from the Oshawa Generals, Jeff Ware.
And they do that with Jeff Ware. An interesting story with Jeff Ware. He has a lot of upside potential, as scouts like to say. His brother Mike plays in the Toronto system already, but I mean, what's the worst case scenario with Jeff Ware if he doesn't become a big skill guy? He's 6'4", he's 214 pounds, he'll be the fourth defenseman on your team for 10 years. That's not a bad downside.
Cliff Fletcher on the phone to somebody right now. It'll be interesting to see if there's any complications coming out of this selection of Jeff Ware, but let's concentrate on the Jeff Ware story for a minute. His dad, Jim Ware, was one of the top tax lawyers in Canada. There's nothing trivial about the way this guy plays, but there is something trivial about the way his dad does business, and that is Trivial Pursuit. The guys who invented Trivial Pursuit brought Jim Ware into the fold as their business manager and their top guy, and he has parlayed their Trivial Pursuit wealth into everything you can imagine, from golf courses to restaurants to bars. These guys are financial moguls, and Jim Ware, the father of Jeff Ware, has done a big part of that. Tremendous family, a great sporting background. Queen's University background for Jim Ware as a football player. His brother, as you said, Mike, playing with the St. John's Maple Leafs, signed as a free agent. And this kid didn't develop the way that a lot thought that he would, but I'll tell you, as you say, Paul, when you're 6'4" and 220 pounds and can skate and handle a puck, he's got tremendous amount of potential. Hey. An opportunity to be one of the really good defensemen in this draft. Well, it just didn't develop as quickly as some of the other guys. But, hey, man, they're just babies. They're 18 years old, and everybody develops at a different rate. Could be your classic late bloomer and a great pick for the Toronto Maple Leafs.
With Cliff Fletcher now, and Cliff, we knew that the Leafs wanted to get a defenseman. Tell me about Jeff Ware and what you like about him.
Well, Jeff Ware is big, strong. He's extremely mobile for a big man. Last year was his first year playing major junior hockey. He has a great future ahead of him, both as a player and as a leader.
Did you have any thoughts to trading down at all?
Well, we're looking around, but I'll give you a little scoop. We've already made a trade for a veteran defenseman that we'll be announcing in an hour or so. So that, you know, took away the incentive to trade down. We're very happy with a youngster like Jeff Ware. Now we have a brother act in our organization.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Jeff is 6'4", 214 pounds, and finally I get to look down at an interview. Hey, you've got to be pretty happy going to the Toronto Maple Leafs.
It's an incredible feeling. Growing up, watching the Maple Leafs play, and my brother in the organization, it's just a dream come true. Playing for my home team, it's going to be incredible.
You've had an awful lot of opportunity to watch Pat Burns' system. You think you're going to fit into it well?
I hope so. I'm going to try my best to fit into the team.
I think right now with your size, Pat Burns is wetting his pants.
Let's hope not. Well, Gary and Jeff are the same weight, anyways.
Well, not quite the same height. Pat Burns.
More still to come. Jeff Ware, now a member of the Toronto Maple Leafs. And also, we're going to talk a little bit, speculate a bit about that Toronto deal that Cliff Fletcher let us in on. Sort of. More still to come on the 1995 NHL Entry Draft.
There are those who go flat out just for the fun of it, and those who don't. When you go after it like this, you work up a thirst. Now, how you choose to quench that thirst depends on the answer to this simple question. Are you a man or a mouse? Hey, life is a sport. Drink it up.
For a healthy decision.
Crisp Crunch.
You can't beat that. McCain Super Fries is where it's at.
Great tasting, crispy McCain Super Fries are prepared with 100% non-hydrogenated canola oil, so they contain just half a gram of saturated fat per serving.
More than that, they taste just great. So get the facts there on the pack.
McCain Super Fries, low in saturated fats for a healthy decision.
Now you can't beat that.
Just recap some of the picks for you. Picks 8 to 14, number 15, Toronto Maple Leaf pick. Ware just taken, Jeff Ware. And also, boy, just a great bit of bait tossed out there by Cliff Fletcher.
Gives us the unofficial word on a trade for a veteran defenseman. I'll be perfectly honest, Paul, I don't know who the defenseman is, but if they've had to trade a player off the roster, I know that there have been some teams inquiring about Benoit Hogue's availability. Now, Hogue had a bad playoff with the Toronto Maple Leafs, but he's obviously a proven 30 to 40 goal scorer, and there may be a market for him there if the Leafs can bolster that defense. And that is Cliff Fletcher's goal today, is to come out of here with
the
not
next
one defenseman, but maybe two veteran defensemen.
Belongs to the Buffalo Sabres.
Buffalo Sabres just picked at 14 because of that deal they made involving Alexander Mogilny earlier today with the Vancouver Canucks. They took Vancouver's first round pick, 14th overall. Here is Buffalo's pick, number 16. And I'm going to say it again, I've said it for the last four or five picks.
Peter Sikora
is still there.
And so is Brad Church, a very impressive two-way winger with the Prince Albert Raiders. Might fit right into what Coach John Muckler's trying to do here. Tough day for Peter Sikora. A lot of people
Let's try to explain why his stock has dropped so much.
Well, he separated his shoulder at the World Junior Championships and never played a game. He had a shoulder surgery. There's no reason to believe that his shoulder isn't 100% healthy, but he's the smallish, offensive, European and that sometimes works against you. And it's really, the draft is a funny thing, the way it works. I know for a fact that there were two or three teams up around in the top six or seven who have Peter Sikora right behind the guy that they took. So it was so very, very close. If one of the teams up there hadn't gotten the player that they wanted, then the next player that they wanted was Peter Sikora, and he very easily could have been taken with the fourth, fifth, or sixth, or seventh pick overall. But now all of a sudden here he is sitting at number 16, still waiting for his name to be called. It's got to be disconcerting to him. But on a team that just lost Alexander Mogilny, I'll tell you what, you've lost a lot of skill and a lot of goals. Sabres could do a lot worse than to take a gifted young center who a lot of people believe is just, he's excelled offensively at every level of hockey he's ever played at.
Select from Beaupert, Martin Biron.
So the second goaltender in this draft has taken Jean-Sébastien Giguère from the Quebec Major Junior Hockey League, was taken earlier. And it is Biron, the man who he battled for much of the year for the title of number one goaltender in the Quebec Major Junior Hockey League. Martin played with the Beauport Harfangs.
Where's number 00 for the Beauport Harfangs? I asked him if that was his desired goals against average, and he thought that was pretty good. He got no particular reason why he wears that number. He says when he came to camp and training camp, they gave it to him just as a training camp number, and he liked it, did well, made the team, and decided that that was a good enough number for training camp. He was going to keep it. And I'll tell you what, this kid is 6'3", 150-odd pounds, and he obviously has to get a little stronger and a little more physically mature before he's going to play in the National Hockey League. And when you're 6'3", and you're a stand-up goaltender, there's something to be said for the amount of net that you cover, even if you are 150 pounds. And we've seen the importance of goaltenders, Paul, in the playoffs, and I think more and more you're going to see more goaltenders going higher in the first round on a regular basis. We've now had two goaltenders taken in the first 16 picks, and when you see the job that Martin Brodeur has done with the New Jersey Devils, the job that Felix Potvin has done with the Toronto Maple Leafs, and you go back to it again, just a goaltending factory coming out of Quebec, the Sabres now pick themselves up in Jay McKee, a very good young defensive prospect.
The Buffalo Sabres
rebuilding from the back end of a rebuilding process that started today with the trading of Alexander Mogilny to the Vancouver Canucks. They picked up Mike Wilson, a 6'6" guy from the Sudbury Wolves, another project on defense. So they're building from the back out. And John Muckler, who for so many years was an offensive-minded coach with the Edmonton Oilers, and why wouldn't he be with that talent, is now looking to turn the defensive makeover of the Buffalo Sabres.
Well, the trend towards taking a goaltender really started to creep up the last couple of years, and we're seeing it continue this year. Jamie Storr, who's going to be a great National Hockey League goaltender, I believe, was taken by the LA Kings. Eric Fichaud was taken by the Toronto Maple Leafs, has subsequently been traded. Mentioned Yevgeny Ryabchikov earlier on, Russian-developed goaltender taken by the Boston Bruins. Trevor Kidd was taken very high in the draft, now with the Calgary Flames. And next up, the new logoed Washington Capitals.
The 17th selection in the 1995 NHL entry draft belongs to the Washington Capitals.
And that is Jack Button.
So we're going to throw Peter Sikora's name back up for consideration?
Not even going to mention it. Who? Jack Button walking up there with the jersey. We'll make the selection for the Washington Capitals. Who signed Brendan Witt, their first-round pick a couple of years ago in 1993, signed him at the deadline.
Well, there's another European that the Washington Capitals do like in addition to Peter Sikora would be Dmitry Nabokov. Big, strong, physical center, plays more of a North American style.
David Poile looking for work ethic and character. Would give up a little along the skill line, so he says. And still waiting for Pat Peek to become the prolific scorer at the professional level that he was at the junior level.
I'll tell you what, they've got tremendous depth on defense now with Brendan Witt, Nolan Baumgartner, Kalle Johansson, Sylvain Cote.
Yeah, you'll see Witt step right into the lineup next year. That'll have Jim Schoenfeld smiling, you bet.
Brendan Witt, not quite as big as Jim Schoenfeld was when Schoenfeld played in the National Hockey League, but I'll tell you what, they both give those bone-jarring checks, and it's a big relief for the Washington Capitals organization to get Brendan Witt into the fold. I'll tell you, Paul, it was like a fire drill last night watching the last few dying seconds to try to get Brendan Witt. There was a jammed fax machine that almost cost the Washington Capitals the approval to get Brendan Witt signed by midnight. Otherwise, he would have re-entered the draft today.
Yeah, that was the deal, in case you're unfamiliar with the situation. He had to be signed, along with Todd Bertuzzi, another player in a similar situation, drafted 2 years ago, had to be signed by midnight Eastern last night, or else they went back into the draft this year as virtually free agents. A second-round pick would have basically been the compensation.
And there it is, the new logo. Big improvement over the word capital spelled out with a hockey stick.
Missed the red, white, and blue, though, I've got to say.
Absolutely, absolutely. Didn't change it to the Washington Screaming Eagles. They still are the Capitals, but I'm sure that's a logo that'll meet with greater approval from the young consumers out there that just coerce mom and dad to fork over the money for a new jersey.
The ubiquitous aqua teal color that we're seeing everywhere also in there.
The Capitals are very pleased to select from the Prince Albert Raiders of the Western Hockey League left winger Brad Church.
Big Brad Church, who didn't win the Masters, despite the green jacket there, although I understand he's a pretty good golfer. 6'1", 210 pounds. And he was bothered this year with a shoulder injury, which cost him a shot at Canada's national team for the World Junior Championship. But a big, strong, and someone the Capitals hope will be dominant forward.
Well, he's the pride of Dauphin, Manitoba. And he is the big prototypical pro winger, comes in with that hard shot from the left wing. Really likes to mix it up. Some scouts have compared him favorably to Keith Tkachuk, the very feisty captain of the Winnipeg Jets. And there's no question that the shoulder injury did bother him over the course of the season. The Washington Capitals, like every other team here, the theme today is size and strength. Everybody wants to get bigger. They want to get stronger. You see guys like Bill Guerin patrolling the wing for the New Jersey Devils. Nothing flashy, just out there doing their job and making it difficult for the skilled players to operate. And as a result, a skilled player like Peter Sikora sitting on the sideline while the Churches happily see their man go off to Landover, Maryland for Washington Capitals.
Brad's offensive totals a little bit low, but in the same situation as Steve Kelly, his teammate. A very powerful Prince Albert team offensively, very deep, and that's going to take away a little bit from your ice time and your chance to score.
Well, I'm with Mr. and Mrs. Church right now. First of all, congratulations. How do you feel?
Well, I feel very, very proud. It's just great.
Have you ever been to Washington, and have you ever met Bill Clinton?
No, I haven't, but I would love to.
Well, you're probably going to Washington, and you'll might not meet Bill Clinton, but you'll probably meet Abe Pollin. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Abe probably a little more popular than Bill right now.
Well, congratulations, Brad. You were another one yesterday who said you weren't quite sure where you're going to be going. What do you know about the Washington Capitals?
I was down there a couple weeks. It's a real nice city. Jack Button, real nice guy. It seemed like a real class organization, and I'm really excited. This is great.
How much a factor is that size and strength of yours, do you think? Is that the biggest asset you bring into the National Hockey League?
For sure. I mean, it's my total game. If I don't play physical, I'm pretty much useless out there. And I hope to bring that to the Washington Capitals.
You look pretty excited now.
I am. This is the best.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
And speaking of popularity, he could be a real popular guy on a team throwing out those bone-crunching, bone-jarring checks. 6'1", 210 pounds.
Nice to see Brad Church go there, and it's also nice to see Jack Button with the Washington Capitals. Jack collapsed at a tournament in Germany and was actually critically ill there for a while. It was touch and go. He's got a chronic blood disorder that they're treating, and the prognosis is excellent. It's great to see Jack Button back with the Washington Capitals. I'm sure the entire hockey community agrees.
He's been with the organization for years. Is he a day one, or he'd be pretty close to?
I used to be with NHL selection. Central Scouting, the Pittsburgh Penguins, and he and David Poile.
NHL entry draft belongs to the Stanley Cup champion, New Jersey Devils.
The Devils with the next pick. I wonder if they'll go for a big player, too.
Well, they've got an awful lot of big players. They've got some great skill players, too. David Connie, the chief scout, has always been a guy who's like size and strength, but also very impressed with skills. So Peter Sikora has got to be a consideration for them at this point.
A big physical center, really? Ask Scott Bowman about that. They give him to the coaches to raise, and the New Jersey coaching staff, Jacques Lemaire, Larry Robinson, have done a tremendous job of developing the talent on that team. What a job they've done with Scott Niedermeyer.
And they won the Calder Cup of the American League this year, and won the Stanley Cup. Vadim Sherefyanov came and joined the Albany River Rats late in the season. He's projected to join the team next year and play on a regular basis. Got some good young defensemen in the system. Very well constructed, and constructed largely through the draft. And here's the man who puts it all together. David Connie says, we adopt the children, give them the coaches to raise. David Connie had a great line once about the vagaries of the 18-year-old draft. He says it's like trying to go into about 10th or 11th grade in high school and pick out the guys who are going to be the doctors and the dentists just by looking at their marks. And that's very much what this draft is like. Unlike so many of the drafts, the NBA draft, the NFL draft, most of the players that are drafted here today are not ready to step in and play in the National Hockey League. In fact, there may only be one or two or three of them that are actually playing in the league next year. This is more akin to the baseball-style draft, where the players are going to ferment for a while, they're going to develop their talents before they burst onto the scene.
Yeah, it is a real crapshoot. That's a great analogy from David Connie. Let's see who they take.
The New Jersey Devils are proud to select from the Detroit Vikings, Petri Sikora.
That'd be the Detroit Vipers, the other team in Detroit, and it's Petri Sikora who finally gets taken. You said they like skilled players. They have one here. Tremendously skilled Petri Sikora. Only played 29 games this year because of that shoulder injury that he suffered. But I believe, going this late, I think he's a steal.
Absolutely, and I know that the New Jersey Devils are going to go down and talk to the local media, and General Manager Lou Lamoriello and David Conti are going to say, we couldn't believe that Petri Sikora was there. And, you know, general managers and chief scouts say that every year, but I'll tell you what, in this case, it goes without saying that it's true, because a lot of people really believe that Petri Sikora, some people projected that he might fall out of the top 10, but nobody in their wildest imagination would have dreamt that he'd go down as far as number 18.
Do you think that his stock dropped a little bit, Bob, because Radek Bonk, a guy who the Ottawa Senators took in a similar situation, not with the injury, but Radek, rather than playing junior hockey, played professional hockey in the International League with the same team, with a different team in the same league, the International League. And Bach didn't exactly explode onto the scene with Ottawa this year. He was very underwhelming at times. So do you think people were thinking about that when they were thinking about Petri Sikora?
There's no question about that. I think, though, there's a big difference between Petri Sikora and Radek Bonk. One of them is the negative. Radek Bonk is a big, 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 strong guy, and Petri Sikora is not. Petri Sikora is listed as 5'11", 167 pounds, and that's not big by National Hockey League standards in a year when the emphasis is on size and strength. We're going to hammer that point home a thousand times today, but I'll tell you what, there's no substitute for skill either. And this kid, when he played as a 16-year-old in the World Junior Championships, he scored goals and was a point producer. He would have been a point producer in this year's World Junior Championships if he hadn't separated his shoulder. He scored goals and points with the Detroit Vipers, had a good year with them, 12 goals, 17 assists, and 29 points in 29 games. People talk about the attitude of European players. I talked to Rick Dudley about this player. Rick Dudley, the coach of the Detroit Vipers, does not tolerate loafers, does not tolerate guys that aren't coachable. And Rick Dudley says he can't imagine anybody having a problem with this guy's coachability.
Well, I'm with Peter and David Conte right now. First of all, Peter, congratulations on going to the Stanley Cup Champions. How do you feel?
Oh, I feel great. This is the best day in my life. And I really happy to go to New Jersey. This is the best day.
Are you healthy now? You feel good?
Yeah, I feel much, much better. You know, it's pretty hard. Just sit there and wait for some team. And now I feel all great.
David, are you surprised that he was there?
Well, I don't know. Nothing ever really surprised me, but I'm very pleased he was there.
How much of an opportunity do you have to watch him all year? And what do you like about this guy? There's a lot to like.
Well, it's not just this year. It's over a couple years. And he's got speed, he plays with enthusiasm, and he's got personality on the ice. And we can all use those talents.
Going to Stanley Cup champions, what a thrill.
And with me now is the general manager, Lou Lamoriello, who made that pick. A lot of us are surprised Petri Sikora was still around. How surprised are you?
Well, we were very happy that he was there. Last year, we had liked him a lot. You know, it's only 1 month to determine whether he could get drafted or not. And we had him rated pretty highly, so we were delighted to have him there. And we feel very good about it, especially being a center iceman.
Obviously, his stock dropped because of the injury. How concerned are you in weighing this out?
Well, we did the ample testing, I think, as a lot of other people. We feel very comfortable that he's fine, and we look forward to having him. We're just delighted that we were able to get him.
Not bad for the Stanley Cup champs. Thank you.
Thank you.
And there aren't many with a better eye for talent than David Conte with New Jersey, which leads you to believe Sikora could be a real steal. We are through 18 picks, the 1995 NHL entry draft on TSN and ESPN2. We'll be right back.
Yeah, I took the High Endurance Challenge from Old Spice because I didn't really think it could work better than my old deodorant. But it does. It evaporates less quickly, it also lasts longer, protects better against odor. Now you got proof. Guaranteed.
What's so new about new Speedstick Clear deodorant?
Take a look at this gel. See? It's wet and sticky. And mine, it goes on dry.
New Speedstick Clear. It's more than clear. It's clearly dry.
By Madden.
Hey, I'll take dry any day.
Today, you've got to have a copier and a printer for your computer, maybe even a scanner, and imagine doing business without a fax. Now, more space would be nice. But that's more overhead. Time for Mita, the digital copier that faxes, a fax that can print, a printer that scans, a scanner that makes coffee. Just kidding. The new Mita AM1000, a whole office in 2 square feet.
On July 8th, TSN divvies up the action with Labatt Blue Jays baseball and the CFL live on TSN. Starting at 4 Eastern, sports fans across Canada will tune in to see a nonstop day of action from the gridiron and the diamond. Everyone can catch the Jays and the A's at 4 Eastern, doubleheader in Ontario. The rest of the country cheers on the Stamps at Shreveport this Saturday on TSN.
Selection in the 1995 NHL Entry Draft belongs to the Chicago Blackhawks.
Up next, Chicago. And by the way, just as an aside, the Toronto Maple Leafs announcing a trade for a veteran defenseman. And we're trying to ferret out who that veteran defenseman is. We take a look at Chicago's team needs. They are an older team, that's for sure.
Well, you've got to look hard at a center and defenseman. You always take the best, get your assets higher, Bob Murray. Chicago Blackhawks are a team that are very interested. They are buyers right now in the market. They believe they have a good team. They believe they have a team that can win the Stanley Cup in the next little while as they introduced Eric Daze into the playoffs this year. Ethan Morrow, Steve McLaren, a big tough defenseman from the North Bay Centennials. And this is a team that's going to be very interested in making some very big and bold moves. They've got a new coach in Craig Hertzberg. But a team that's not going to sit back and wait for the future. They believe the future is now, and they're going to be putting on a big press the next little while. They made significant attempts to try and get the second pick overall from the New York Islanders.
That is Bob Pulford, by the way.
And at this point in time, if the gentleman looks standing behind Bob Pulford looks a little familiar to you, he should. It's Dave Keon Jr., the son of Dave Keon Sr. Of course, there's a little connection right there, and if there isn't a striking resemblance, that looks like Dave Keon and Bob Pulford. Looks like the 1967 Leafs are having a reunion at the Chicago table right now. But I'll tell you, these are uncharted waters right now. The draft is highly subjective at this point. Fairly accurate, reasonably accurate up to the first 14 or 15 picks as to the players that are going right now as we round out this first round with another, what, 7 picks left in the first round. There's a pool of anywhere from 20 to 30 players that teams are considering. They're going to go all over the map. Chicago Blackhawks, I think all things being equal, would like to get a big defenseman. And defense is a strength of theirs, but it's also a bit of a concern in terms of the age of their defenseman.
Well, if you're looking at a defenseman, Jason Doig would be a candidate, although he's a bit of a project, but he's big, 6'3", 216 pounds. If you're looking for a forward,
wings, Dmitry Nabokov.
Dmitry Nabokov would be the man.
And there's their big center that we talked about. Not at all a prototypical Russian-style player. This guy is much more of a North American style. Nabokov is big and strong and plays a physical game.
Exactly. He lacks the pure skill, but he's a real catalyst, not unlike Lemieux and the New Jersey Devils. That's a favorable comparison. He's good in the corners. He's good down low. He likes to mix it up and make things happen. And sometimes that can make up for a lack of pure offensive touch.
6'2", 187 pounds.
And actually a line mate of another player who has yet to go in this draft but could go very shortly, Alexei Morozov, both playing for Krylia Sovetov in Russia.
Well, teams are really split as to who they like better, Nabokov or Morozov. Anytime you get two draft-eligible players who play on the same line, on the same team, there's going to be inevitable comparisons. Morozov is much more the high-skill Alexei Kovalev-type winger. Really fancy with the puck, blinding speed, very creative. Nabokov is much more certain in terms of his play, more of a plotter in terms of a skater, but also more physical, a little more aggressive. The knock on him is he sometimes has a tendency to get a little bit lazy. But again, we hark back to the size and strength factor at 6'2", 287 pounds. You look at a guy like that and you wonder if 5 or 6 years down the road, he might not be doing a job for the Chicago Blackhawks the way Bobby Holík did a job for the New Jersey Devils. The difference, Holík was originally projected when he was first drafted by the Hartford Whalers in the first round a number of years ago as a big offensive superstar, the big, almost an Eric Lindros type player.
Yeah, but you're not going to see Dmitry step in and play for the Hawks next year.
No, not at all.
He's a project. But he's a big project, literally and figuratively, perhaps 6'2", 187 pounds.
The Chicago Blackhawks
Russian development. Boy, you see so many players the last few years since the world has changed, since the Iron Curtain has come down, just an influx of great talent coming into the NHL. And Nabokov maybe another fine example of that talent coming out of Russia, the Ukraine, Czech Republic. Here's Rod Smith.